I am Terry Huh, and I am part of the planning committee that brought this incredibly informative and exciting conference together. And I represent, yes, and I represent the Geriatric Research Education and Clinical Center at the VA Palo Alto Healthcare System. So, our next speaker is Dr. Ayati, well-known nationally and internationally in the field of geriatric medicine. He is a physician, speaker, author, educator, and a board-certified geriatrician. Dr. Ayati completed his residency at UC Davis, his fellowship at Stanford University, and received the Award of Excellence in Clinical Teaching while at UC Davis. Currently, he serves as editor-in-chief on the Journal of General Medicine, Open Access, is a frequent educational speaker on several radio stations, and enjoys presenting at local conferences and abroad. Dr. Ayati has worked in many California hospitals, including subacute and rehabilitation centers, both in the attending role and at the director's level. He was assistant professor of Stanford University and currently practices at Geriatric Concierge Center in Menlo Park, and continues his teaching as a volunteer educator at Stanford and VA Palo Alto for the Geriatric Fellowship Program. Dr. Ayati's main areas of research and clinical practice are in physiology of aging and discovering innovative yet practical ways for patients to achieve high quality, meaningful, healthy lives despite living with a medical diagnosis. Dr. Ayati strives to provide reliable information, effective coping strategies, simple guidelines for disease management and prevention, while instilling hope in all patients regardless of age, by setting attainable goals and leading with his heart, which I can personally attest to. So please, let's give a warm welcome to Dr. Ayati.
Thank you so much. Okay. Wow, thank you. Thank you, Taylor.
Okay, well, good morning, everyone. And okay, well, thank you so much first for inviting me. I'm so delighted and honored to be here. I feel Alzheimer's Association is like my home, and I just come back to home again. And at this hotel has always been some conference and seminar for Alzheimer's Association. That's why it's so pleased to be. And also, I wanted to say I'm so honored to be introduced by Dr. Terry Ha. I was actually, when I was fellow at Stanford Geriatric Medicine, Terry was my faculty, and I learned a lot from her. And I wish that we have, like, if we have 10 or 20 Terry Ha in this community, I guarantee that our elderly care is going to be significantly improved. And that's why, again, I'm so humbled and honored to be introduced by her. Now, let's just talk about sexuality and dementia. You learned this morning a lot from Dr. Henderson. He was also my faculty when I was, it's just so embarrassing for me to standing here. But, and I learned a lot from him. Here's Dr. Henderson, is the best neurologist at Stanford. But now we're talking about sexuality and dementia. It's a topic that is not including a lot of the high technology medicine. It's just more coming from, again, it's a mixture of medicine and law and a lot of the principles and ethics. Now, there's a couple of disappointments I have for you. I'm not a lawyer. And I have no knowledge about the law, and I'm also, bad news, I'm also not a good physician. And I'm also doesn't have any administrative responsibility. That's why, stay with me, I try to make some point today. Maybe we're gonna learn something from each other. By the way, please, there is a seat in front, and I'm actually gonna ask my difficult question from the people sitting on the back. That's why, don't be shy. If you want, just come in front. Now, before we start, it is very important to say these things, which is, if you have any cultural background, religious background, any values, any personal things, because of this topic, there's a garbage bag on the back, I mean, in the back of this auditorium, and please leave it there for 1 hour, because if you need to open your mind for this discussion, because it's a very, very important topic, we ignore it in many places. And that's why I really like to have free, open mind and just talk about sexuality and dementia. I wanted to first ask a couple of questions. Do you agree with that, that sexuality is a basic human need? Yes or no? Okay. Do you think if somebody has appropriate sexual behavior, even if they, when they are getting old, is it considered to be disease or not? It's normal. Well, that's the reason I'm saying, because a lot of time we actually consider it a disease. And again, sexually in later life, and again, its relationship in dementia is a neglected topic. Do you agree with that? Now, if you agree with any of them, you don't need to sit in the rest of my talk. You can enjoy your break, come back for lunch after lunch, and the next speaker. But if you have some questions about that, that I'm trying to help you with this presentation. This is true that actually, and now, the next question here, that we have some critical question. Do the people with dementia can have sex? Yes, that's good. Good, yes. I hear a lot of yes. But when it comes to the policy, when it comes to the places, and when it comes to the families of the patients that they have dementia, this yes is not always yes. It's a lot of the shaking head, and I say, oh, it's very embarrassing, don't even talk about it. But that's a very important thing that we're going to discuss today. And again, are they capable to make consent? Because that's going to come to the, all these questions from a lot of people working as a social worker in the long-term facility and always asking questions, is this person has capacity to have a sex? The other thing is, what is the current policy right now? If you guys working in any facilities or any places, home care and all this stuff, do you have your written policy in your hand? Have you ever read your policy? Is there any policy? No, that's a case. We always say yes, but when it comes to the policy, there's not too many policies. And believe me, Northern California is one of the worst places. And have we trained people about that? And I'm so, again, glad that at least Alzheimer's Association take a step in and try to train the people about this topic that, that we talk about the people with dementia. And I'm, as a geriatrician, I'm happy to discuss about it. Now, there is a lot of things that we, I mean, you guys are agreed that this, even the people when they're aging, and I'm telling you as a geriatrician, even this is going to be a last question I ask my patient when they come to see me, that how is your sexual life? And I always ask, well, what is your blood pressure medication? By the way, have you refilled your blood pressure medication? Your cholesterol is so high, your diabetes is all over the place, and we never have a time to discuss about this important topic. This is another topic that we need to talk about, aging and sex. But definitely in the lot of reports showing the people that have even like, for example, in 54 to 64, and again, when it comes down to 65 to 74, which we call it young geriatric people, and when it comes to middle-aged geriatric people, which we call 75 to 84, are you familiar with young geriatric, middle-aged? Okay. And they still, they have some sexual activity. Now, let's just go back to a statement from WHO about sexuality that is a central aspect of being human throughout the life. And again, it encompasses sex, gender identities and roles, sexual orientation, erotism, pleasure, intimacy, and reproduction. Sexuality is experienced and expressed in thoughts, fantasies, desire, beliefs, attitude, values, behavior, practices, rules, and relationship. While sexuality can include all of these dimensions, not all of them are always experienced or expressed. Sexuality is influenced by, again, interaction of biological, psychological, social, economic, political, culture, and ethical, legal, historical, religious, and spiritual factors. Now, keep in mind that there is a two different topics here. One is sex, one is intimacy. And a lot of people kind of like confused between these two topics because, again, a lot of other pleasurable aspects can happen in the both partner. One of them can have dementia, one of them have some cognitive impairment. And we it's not necessary penetrating sexual intercourse. That's something we ignore it in a lot of places, a lot of long-term places, a lot of the memory care unit. And again, the fact is, onset of dementia, when you come to me, you come to Dr. Henderson's office and we diagnose you, label you with, oh, congratulations, you have dementia, it doesn't mean that you have a signal of the end of the healthy sexual life. And that's a very, very important thing we need to know that. Relationship is actually change over time. And again, many couples that they actually are still very close for their sexual relationship And they have a different type of expression. That's something we should know that. Some couples are come to discover a new and different way to actually to sharing closeness and comfort and intimacy. That's something we also have to know about that. And again, for many couples, again, coping with dementia, physical intimacy actually continues to be a rich source of mutual comfort, support, and pleasure for many years. And we know that, even touching the hand. Now, the main issue is here. It's a tons of controversial. Again, what is appropriate behavior and what is inappropriate sexual behavior? And it has a lot of factors. A lot of factors, it comes to me as a physician when I have the case in my hand. I'm coming from different cultural background. I'm actually raised and grew up in the third world country in the Middle East, and talking about a sex, especially if I know my grandparents have a sex, oh my God, they're killing. And now I am as a physician sitting in the office and somebody comes and say, your grandfather has dementia and your grandmother, they're gonna have a sex. I even never thought about my parents. And even discussion about that. Now think about it, we have in memory care, we have a lot of caregivers, CNA, nurses, and they're all trained and comes from different country, different culture background. And they're taking care of elderly dementia patient. And there's a lot of things going on. That's why it's a lot of the contraindication. I mean, there's a lot of controversy here. It's going on about the discussion about the sex. Some of the example, we'll talk about it. A lot of people, they think about, okay, if the dementia patient is going to have masturbation in the memory care unit, that's considered inappropriate sexual behavior. That's something that we want to talk about it. And this is not necessary in inappropriate sexual behavior. It can be absolutely appropriate sexual behavior. And again, or we label them as a hypersexual. The next thing, call Ayati. Can we give some antipsychotic to this patient? Because they're doing a lot of masturbation in memory care unit. That's the way we do. But again, sometimes there is a problem in the cognitive impairment because, again, it happens in the wrong place because they're very confused that this is not their home, this is not. And again, the other things, it's happened in an area, again, may confuse public and private area for a lot of demented patients, and they kind of misidentify, this is my spouse, this is my partner, and that's why they can have some behavior that we label them and is inappropriate sexual behavior, and then we always looking at. The other things, if you guys having any memory care, any long-term care facility, please raise your hand if there is any room for sexual activity or intimacy in your facilities. Is it one person? There was one or two. If you go somewhere around the world, there are many countries, they actually are starting to have this discussion. They have a private room for the people, and even in the long-term care facility, that they address this issue. It's not France, by the way, but if you think about it, but there are many countries that are doing that. But I'm just something that we wanted to open up the discussion. There's no place in the long-term facility. Now, let's just go to the news, because we talk about can the dementia people, they can have a sex. And probably you hear about something in the news. In Iowa, we had one of the famous people actually found that have a sex with his wife, and the case went to the long litigation, and then finally, the charge was dropped. But that's bringing the question about that. What does it mean with mental incapacity? Because, every time this gentleman's visiting the wife, they're saying that they have some sexual intercourse. They complain about him. There was a charge. And that's why I'm going to ask Tim to have for the next, here. Oh, here's. For the next, this is the former Iowa legislation that actually have no guilty of sexual for the wife. Now, the next slide, because you guys are driving so early morning here, I'm going to have 2 or 3 minutes be quiet and listen to a report from NPR. I was actually just recently, almost a year now, but 3 minutes, listen, and then we'll come back for the discussion, please.
A case in Iowa has put a spotlight on the issue of sexual relationships in nursing homes. Today, a jury acquitted former state lawmaker Henry Rahans of sexually abusing his wife last May. He was accused of having sex with her after nursing home staff told him she was no longer capable of consenting. She had Alzheimer's disease and died in August. Sex in long-term care facilities isn't uncommon, but as NPR's Ina Jaffe reports, the long-term care industry is still grappling with the issue.
The fact that some people with dementia still have sex lives isn't news at the Hebrew Home in Riverdale, New York. They've had a written policy to help staff manage such relationships for 20 years.
It was controversial in 1995, and it's controversial today.
Daniel Reingold is the CEO of River Spring Health, a nonprofit that runs the Hebrew Home.
We knew that there was intimacy occurring, and we considered it to be a civil right and a legal right. And we also felt that intimacy was a good thing, that touch is one of the last pleasures we abandon and lose as we age.
Reingold says the policy also protects residents from unwanted sexual contact, and he argues that people with dementia are indeed capable of giving consent.
People who have Alzheimer's disease or dementia are asked on a daily basis to make decisions about their desires, from what they eat to activities that they may want to engage in,
including intimacy with another person. But even with a written policy, it's not that easy for nursing homes to figure out when consent to sex is really valid, says Evelyn Tenenbaum, a professor of law at Albany Law School and bioethics at Albany Medical College.
For example, suppose you have a couple and the woman believes that the man that she's seeing is her husband, and then she consents to a sexual relationship. Is that really consent if she doesn't understand who he is and that she's not married to him?
Sometimes in such cases, nursing homes will defer to the wishes of the resident's family, says Tenenbaum.
On the other hand, nursing homes are required to take care of psychosocial needs of their residents. And whether psychosocial needs would include sexual relationships is a question.
A question with no commonly accepted answer. The American Healthcare Association, a trade group representing the majority of nursing homes, only suggests its member facilities develop their own policies. Patricia Bach, a geriatric psychologist, says when she started looking into the topic, she didn't find much.
There was very, very little empirical evidence, little data, few research studies, and it really was a lower priority issue for long-term care providers.
So, with a colleague, she surveyed members of the American Medical Directors Association, which represents physicians who work in long-term care facilities.
Only 25% to 30% actually have formal training in the area of intimacy and sexuality, as it would pertain to older adults. 30% had no training at all.
And only about 30% of nursing homes had formal policies, something which needs to change and fast, says Daniel Reingold of River Spring Health and the Hebrew Home.
We are dealing with the arrival of my fellow baby boomers who have grown up in an environment where sexuality was a much more open conversation and activity.
And there's no reason to think that will change, he says, even when those boomers are in long-term care. I'm Jackie, and we are news.
Great. No, have some idea. How much physicians have been trained about that? It's 30%. I think it's probably less. And then how much we actually have policy in our facilities. Takes about, even all the people have been very confused looking at the research data. There's not too much we actually done. And the reality is that, as discussed at the beginning of this conference, we're actually facing a huge number of aging population and also dementia people, and they're going to be tripled in the next years. And what's going to happen with all of this question? The other things that don't forget, in compare of the last generation that they are now facing with dementia, the newer generation, they're more open-minded about sex. And think about this generations will get to the point aging and they get dementia. That's going to be more questions here as far as our policy and what we're going to do in the future. Looking at the fundamental rights for long-term care facilities, it is important that we have respect to the person, residence, autonomy, definite privacy, and they actually have to have all the long-term care, they have the right to appropriate accommodation for a consensual sexual relationship. And all the person have a right to just say, okay, no, and then even the long-term care facility prevent any aggression between residence to residence in the sexual life. Now, the next thing about is important, that there is a definitely big issue here. We have capacity, we have competency, that used to say competency, now we say legal capacity. Competency is not going to be determined by a physician, it's only comes by a court of law. and actually this is a different thing. When it comes to capacity, there's actually every person's physical and mental ability to relate to speak a task. And the capacity is very important because, for example, they can exert the will, they can actually consent for medical treatment, and also they can have a consent for sexual consent. And again, this is very important that we should assume every demented patient, they have capacity to make a decision. And that's something we should, because the things about happening a lot, even I'm as a practicing geriatrician like in hospital, they always think anybody has a problem with cognitive impairment or dementia, the first thing that they get is the person has capacity to make a decision. And they're always asking the question from a lot of other people. And then it even comes to the medical treatment. So they're going to have advanced dementia. A lot of people actually live in a mild dementia, moderate dementia, maybe MCI, not cognitive impairment, I'm not saying dementia word, but they have capacity to make decisions, even for the medical treatment. And that's something that we ignore and we don't pay attention to. And that's something that neither advanced age, not against a presence of the cognitive impairment, can have something that we say, this person doesn't have capacity to make a decision, as you hear also in the NPR report as well, that is true, and they can also make a decision about that. Now, let's just talk about, is there any test for capacity? And I wanted to tell you, there's no actually single test, but I always said that whenever we wanted to talk about capacity, we need to have, first of all, looking for the values of the person. The also clinician should be aware of the values, and again, this is very, very important that actually values may change over time, but this should not be based on my clinician value. I should absolutely respect to the person's value and then determine what is the capacity. There is a best resource which I recommend if you guys in a long-term facility or any memory care, I'm sure you hear about that. This is from American Bar Association and American Psychology, actually, group. And this is a very, very important question that is, again, this combination of Wittenberg question. And these questions are here. Is the patient aware of relationship? There's three important questions. Is the patient ability to avoid it? And also the patient's awareness of any potential risk. And this is a very, very fundamental question that you first should ask if you have a residence with dementia and you're dealing with that. Patients aware of the relationship, there are some questions coming from here. Is the patient aware of who is initiating sexual contact? Is there any delusion or misidentification happening for the patient? Again, confused that this is the spouse or this is somebody else. And again, the next thing about ability to avoid is the behavior consistent with belief or value. Is the patient has capacity to say no? And that's a very, very important part of assessment. As you guys, I'm sure you're taking care of a lot of people with dementia that ask this question, can they say no to the relationship? The other piece you have to assess if the patient has aware of the risk. One of the risks, we always say about talking about the risk, not only sexual transmitted disease risk, but we always also have to ask if what happened if the relationship is going to be to the end, is the patient going to be more, or the person's going to be more agitated and confused as well. There's another assessment that is important, it's called Linden assessment, which it comes with the knowledge, it comes with the presence of the choice to engage or reject the activity, it comes at rationality as well, which is comes ability to critically weigh pros and cons in a relationship, and that's all about the voluntariness that they actually be able to protect themselves against unwanted sexual abuse in this situation. The policies and procedures in the long-term facilities, I always recommend to review if you have time. There's a website for Hebrew Home Sexual Expression Policy. It's for 20 years, is actually they're one of the best. That's why I'm saying Northern California, we're not doing well, because when you go back to the East Coast, you see more policies actually established in that area. And also, they have a true definition here. Is it abuse? Is it intimacy? And again, and also assessing consent for sexual activity in older adults. Now, what is the ability to express choice? What are your wishes about the relationship? There's all the questions you need to ask. This sexual partner that you have, if you're happy, do you enjoy any sexual contact? And you're going to have some observation. Again, one of the observations that I could strongly recommend is for dementia patients that they're not able to verbally tell you, oh yes, I'm very happy with this relationship. You can see on their, again, nonverbal, and just again, this complicated communication, they may actually say the choices to make them happy. And then after the intimacy, or even the relationship that they have, you feel that they actually are very, very happy. And this is a very important to evaluate the emotion that they have with this relationship as well. Ability to express choices as well, this is also very important. What is your wishes about this relationship? And the next thing about sexual activity, how about the appreciation? Do you know what does it mean to have a sex? What does it mean to you and your partner? What do you do if you wanted to stop? And again, what your partner wants to stop? These are the questions that you should have in your policy and ask for people. And again, looking for the nature of the relationship, emotion and the mood before and after sexual contact. The other topics here that I don't bring it up, but as we living in Northern California and the aging population that we're gonna have, we also have gonna have a lot of bisexual, gay and lesbian as well, and they also need a dementia. And that's the other topic that we haven't discussed a lot, that what's gonna happen to them if they're gonna be ended up in a long-term care facility and also the dementia unit. That's something that we have to discuss more about that. There is some question about personal quality of life choices. Again, was intimacy is important part of your life? What are your social and companionship needs? What's great happiness to you? And again, you're always looking for the past relationship. And this is a very important part, because something that I always recommend to the people ask for from the family members is the person who has been abusive in their life, or they have some abusive relationship in the past. This is a very, very important thing. Or the person who's been very, very hypersexual, have many partners in their life. And I saw Carrie this morning, and just reminded me, Dr. Karen Larson, always asking this question. Always go to the past of the patient and ask this question. Is that guy had many partners and cheating his partner when he was younger? And let's think about in the future if they have the same, because we're going to open up the inappropriate sexual behavior. But these are the questions that's very, very important to talk about. And again, unpack of cognitive impairment, and again, and privacy and intimacy right, responsibility to uphold order and adult choices as well. And again, the conclusion on that part, then we're going to next have it, or next topic, is for inappropriate sexual behavior, is here. First of all, the right to engage in intimate sexual activity is a basic right for all older adults, including those with cognitive impairment. And that's a very, very important thing to discuss about. Capacity of sexual consent must be assessed in the same manner for those who have cognitive impairment in order to provide protection of them. And this is all a good source from American Medical Directorship Association, which they recently changed their name. To uniform the standard for, the determination of sexual consent capacity in the dementia unit. And degree of the capacity, again, requires to have always looking that, because it's going to change, depends on the behavior, and then there can be only intimacy, as I've said, can be penetrating intercourse. And the sexual consent capacity, it's going to change over time. And this is a very, very important of your job to assess the person over time, and not only have one consent and say, okay, well, look at their, they should be assessed because their cognition is going to be changed over time. And that's something we need to discuss. Now, if the patient or the person with dementia cannot express the wishes, again, it's a couple of things you should need to remember. First of all, make sure that you understand the nonverbal sign for having this relationship and also stopping the relationship. And on the other times, a person with, again, something that we have to know, that any person, again, with dementia, it doesn't mean they have lack of capacity to understand the relationship. The other thing that is very, very important, that one of the things is very, very important, that when a person has a capacity to make a decision about their, again, having water or not, just think about they can have this decision as well. And then one of the other things is very, very important at the end in our conclusion, that we definitely should have a policy to any places that for people And one thing that I wanted to say to any one of you today, if you want to learn something today, it's just involve the family. Because, and when I say the involve family, if you guys have a memory care unit, I'd like to see you raise your hand. If you guys discuss in the beginning of registration and then meeting the person, have you ever discussed about it? What's going to happen if your parent or your spouse is going to have a relationship with another partner here or another person here? Have you ever asked this question? No. And that's something that that's why I'm trying to encourage you to think about it. It's a very, very important to involve family. And I'm always saying that bring family at the beginning of conversation. Just explaining it that if they come to the memory unit, they may have ended up with some relationship. This is very, very important. First of all, for children, it's very, very difficult to accept that somebody else is replacing for the partner of the person who died. That probably is their parents, is a dad or mom, and they never wanted to come to this discussion. And again, and that's a very, very important thing, because when they're starting to have kind of this situation, and then the family comes and complains, oh, what happened? I saw my mom the other day was lying in bed with a stranger, the other resident. And that's something that that's what I'm trying to encourage you, to open this discussion at the beginning with all the families. And that's something that I'd like to begin today, the Alzheimer's Association is starting to have this discussion, and also they have a lot of seminars about that, to open up to the public, that people with Alzheimer or any kind of dementia, they still have a right, they may be misidentified, but we have to be, again, aware of consent, we should protect them, but if they have a relationship that makes them happy, that's okay. This is part of the disease. That's something that we need to discuss more with the families as well. One of the other things that I also encourage a lot of people for the future doing it, this is something we call a wish for you for future. If you get dementia, what is your wish about having a sexual relationship if you get dementia and you're not able to talk to yourself? Or you're able to talk to yourself, but you just kind of worry about that you don't know what's going to happen to the disease to you. This is a very, very important. This is a new version of advanced directive that we should put in place and discuss about it earlier before the dementia is actually going to get worse. And this is something that, have you heard about that in many places? Okay, that's something that is there. Look at the data, look at the some of the people brought it up, but this is something that probably going to be the best way for the newer generations that are aging to discuss about it earlier and having also the family be aware of that as well. Now, one of the other things that I wanted to discuss today before I'm actually closing, because this is a very, difficult topic to discuss, is the differentiation between inappropriate sexual behavior and misappropriate sexual behavior as well. And that's something that we wanted to discuss about. Like, for example, a case, 89 years old, moderate to severe disease in a nursing home, it begins approaching female nursing home residents with sexual suggestion, upsetting the family, despite of the move in a different floor, he continues to make inappropriate verbal and sometimes physical sexual advances to our female residents and the staff. And I know because it was a real case, there was even like a psychologist went to see, start to touch an inappropriate part of the body. And that's something, and it's continued to have masturbating inside the residence, I mean the memory care unit. Have you guys had any of these cases? Okay. No, then you are familiar with that. Now, let's just talk about inappropriate sexual behavior, which is, again, very, very ethical and medical, legal complex. There is not too many research about inappropriate sexual behavior. They're talking about ranging between 2% to 3%. But one thing is men is more than women. But other sources said, no, it's actually the same. Majority of the treatment is actually happened for men, not women. Well, I don't know why, but that's something we can discuss. But again, more they are trying to be more physically aggressive, women try to be more verbal when it comes to the inappropriate sexual behavior. Now, but why is that? Why do people have inappropriate sexual behavior? You hear today about all the amyloid protein, tau, and all this stuff, but just simple. Frontal lobe of the brain is a part of the brain that inhibits us to to doing sexual activity or aggressiveness. And think about that people with inappropriate sexual behavior, they may not have it, this part in the brain. Now, let me tell you an example. I'm sure you guys taking care of the kids in your life. And you probably, a lot of you have a children. When you have a toddler, when you have an infant, one thing that they like to do is take off the diaper and just be naked and run away. They don't like to be clothes on, even the ones, because they don't have frontal lobe of the brain hasn't been progressed, all the development yet in the frontal part. That's why they have no idea that they need to cover their genital area. Now, think about your toddler when they were in, I have my son, actually today he's going to be 3 years old, but he always have a problem because he really doesn't want any clothes on. And that's why he always run. But when you think about it, that
this is a sing-along. Have you seen a lot of this toddler when they go to the, like they're bathing, and you know a lot of things in pediatric, they always like to touch the genital area. This is exactly because the part of the brain that does inhibition is not working perfectly. Then what they're going to develop, and that's why when they turn to around the age of 4 and 5 years old, they be aware of their genital area. And that's the time that they start to become shy. They don't like the adult touch their genital area. And that's exactly happening in development. And this is, I remember when I was in medical school, when I was reading the pediatric, all the Freud and Jean Piaget theories and all this stuff, we're reading about it. When I became a geriatrician and taking care of dementia patients, oh, it's interesting. And this is like a backward situation. And that's one of the reasons that you see the similarity of the lot of dementia patients, they don't like to have baths. And that's my discussion always with all of this memory care, that we use a lot of tricks for our kids. We read a story, play music, give a couple of gifts to them to try to make them to come and have a bath. But for dementia patients, we have a heavy caregiver, taking their hands, take their clothes off and putting on the water and do whatever we wanted to wash them. We have to do that. But just think about it, that this is a similar situation. Whatever we do, whatever the trick we do, if we can, that's why a lot of dementia patients, they're doing much better with a specific caregiver for when they wanted to back them. Because they talk to them, and that's why they calm them down, and they're able to do this. And that's just think about, but there's all the things goes to the frontal area, and that's exactly about the situation it's happening. Not only that, it's a lot of other things is going on here. Social factors can be one of the other reasons that, again, can happen to them. And again, lack of privacy, that could be. Other things that can happen inappropriate, which is comes to my territory as a doctor, it comes to the infection. Anything can make them delirious, any cardiac disease, anything can actually happen. They may actually start to have hypersexual behavior. A lot of medication that we use, especially anticholinergic medication, and I want to tell you anticholinergic, like for example, a lot of the medication we use for bladder incontinence, we have this side effect. Benzodiazepine we use, anti-Parkinson medication. I will say that anything has a stimulant, even like we use a lot of the stimulant for a lot of dementia people, they actually can have some hypersexuality as well in their situation. Now, reporting the hypersexual behavior, first of all, if we delay on reporting on the hypersexual behavior, definitely they can have a lot of issues. The studies actually shows that under-reporting of hypersexual behavior may be the result of the caregiver or staff feeling of guilt, shame, or confusion when they face with that. And I see more actually here because we have multicultural caregiver in our memory care unit. And that's why they don't feel comfortable. Again, I'm feeling myself as their position as a CNN caregiver with my cultural background and see somebody has hypersexual behavior. That's all, no, even don't talk about it. I'm not saying to my boss. And that's something that happened. A lot of time they may do something with the caregiver, and the caregiver, they're afraid to bring it up. And again, lack of reporting, it shows in the many a study that, this can be actually delay the right diagnosis. And again, the tendency on the reporting, also, it may cause a lot of the issue. This is one of the best reports that I ever found in the British Journal of Nursing. And by the way, they are the British Association of Nursing. They're doing a wonderful job in training of their nurses. I hope it's going to happen here. But
When we have inappropriate sexual behavior, again, we have to go on our checklist. What in one context that happened, how frequent it happened, what is the factor, who was the person, all those things that you're actually going to go and find. And again, after you have all of this, first of all, instead of yelling and screaming on the person having inappropriate sexual behavior in the hallway, and just bring it to that quiet room and talk to them. One of the major reasons, you have to find some of the cause of that. Maybe this is a delirium. Maybe this is a depression is going on. That's why you need to come and have a discussion in a better situation. And again, definitely go to the past medical history. Definitely go to any past social history, as I discussed to you. Again, the MDS information in any care unit can be helpful. And also looking for any of this disorder. Do they have any mood disorder? Do they have any bipolar disorder?
This is me, especially when they were younger. That was the reason I said one of the best questions from an inappropriate is that, have this guy ever cheated his partner or the other side? But psychosis, any substance abuse in the past, attention seeking behavior, and again, maybe some longest-standing hypersexual. This is the work that you and I need to do before calling me and say, please, antipsychotic medication. And nursing assessment intervention is going to be very important. Again, definitely we need a team. We need an interdisciplinary team. Comprehensive assessment is very, very important for that. And we need definitely detailed medical history, sexual history, medication review. And look for motivation. What actually caused that? And again, one of the things that can cause that, a lot of time, because of the lack of engagement of the frontal lobe, they not necessarily having inappropriate sexual behavior, they may have some of the other reason that for us, Ayati, as physician, is going to be misinterpreted as sexual behavior. Like for example, they need to go to the toilets, but they're not able to say I need to go. They take the pants off and show the genital area. And then we say, oh, this is inappropriate sexual behavior. Believe me, it happened to me as a physician. I've seen this report a lot in my table. They may have a discomfort caused by clothing. They may have a very itchy clothing. They actually, the top of it, the detergents that they actually use it in the facility to make them itch, and that's why they wanted to take this off. And that's sometimes misinterpreted as inappropriate. Sometimes it's very tight clothing. It makes them so warm, but they're not able to express themselves. And that's why they wanted to take the clothes off. And then again, they maybe become agitated. They maybe become bored. I see this trend sometimes, close to Halloween time. A lot of this memory carrying, they put all this, pictures on, and they actually have the costume, and they get agitated, they're scared, and they're starting to have some reaction to some of the things that they see in the environment. They may have the need of touch, something that they lose in their life. That's why they're looking for this touch. Something we really don't pay attention to. And again, misunderstanding other people's needs or behavior, and again, making someone of the kind of chosen partner. One of the things that is very important as far as like that, that's why I just put it, they, a lot of you see that the dementia care unit, they have it closed, and actually they're not able to open it up on the front, and they have to open it up from the back. That's why this actually can be something that may be helpful for them. As far as management, okay, that's a hard part. Because first of all, there's no randomized trial that actually available to showing that, okay, this is something that is haven't done. And the reason, people don't talk about it. Researchers, they don't want to talk about it. Nobody wants to say, okay, let's just do the funds to see how is the research about sexuality in dementia patients. And so we'll give them in the memory care, give them some Aricept and then they get about it one day, they just convert to hospice. That's a sad story. But they leave for many years. But the reality is nobody, and that's the, a lot of the articles is only based on one single report that something happened. Now, non-pharmacologic is always the best thing. Find what is the factors that I told you, and that's something that's very, very difficult. But again, using any distracting strategies, the same thing we do for our kids when they start to nagging, we use all the distracting strategies. We are so good with the children, but we're not good for elderly. In a nursing home, definitely it is necessary to separate people from another residents or a staff member, and when the other person is appeared to be treated by inappropriate sexual. And again, separation can be achieved by moving to another floor, but not kicking out. That's something that we see a lot. And distraction with other activities sometimes help, but for example, one of the best things that actually in men, or even in women, it shows, that try to make it easy with their hands. Some crap, something, that instead of masturbation, that they actually kind of busy with their hand. And that can be very, very helpful. And the other things, again, a referral to a specialized geriatric service, I'm not advertising for myself, but I'm just saying that Australian study shows definitely that for these people, when they have an appropriate sexual behavior, an appropriate referral to psychologists and geriatric geriatricians is actually have a better effect. One of the other things that I really love about being creative, and I like to have an Emory study, and I'm not saying the Emory study is one example, but one of the Emory studies is actually they tried to provide adult, which is pink powder, it's like tree food, and they started to give it to somebody that has an appropriate sexual behavior. And that one thing that happened was definitely inappropriate sexual behavior stopped in that guy. I have the case here. Again, there was a 60-year-old man, there was in Westwood Hospital, 2005, 4 years after dementia and Alzheimer, started touching, grabbing the genital area of staff for the past years. And they put the guy under tons of risperidone, Seroquel, 50 milligram BID, gabapentin, all this stuff. But what happened is actually shows that, again, the medication is starting to kind of like slow him down, but it actually becomes very, very confused and also having the problem with the gait as well. And again, it's just the one thing that happened, we actually start to have distraction. That's why the stuffed animal was very helpful. And this is exactly a replica of the pink panther. And we took the pink panther every night to the vet, and it's more formulated actually the pink panther. And it shows significantly important. Now, if you go travel to England, you see the people giving like one bottle to them at night. They keep this one bottle in their hand, feeling the touch of warmness in their body. They kind of like say, okay, this is the one, because they have lack of touch, the oneness of touch. And that's something comes an expression of inappropriate sexual behavior. But anything you can do creative, that's actually can be good. Now, I'm not making business for all Toys R Us that go and buy and all the stuffed animals today. Probably in the time. Okay. Now, let's just go, because I'm a medical doctor. I've been trained to just look inside the box. And always when it comes to my knowledge, I have no knowledge of two other things. Only things I know in medicine, just prescribe the medication. And that's why when it comes to me, I love my prescription pad, and I always like to write a prescription. And that's the way I do. That's the way we train in Western society medicine. Now, yes, some medication can be helpful, but believe me, they have a lot of side effects coming on. But antidepressant, antipsychotic, antifungal medication, and hormones can be also helpful. Some of the cholinesterase inhibitors are going to have some quick decay support for giving 15 minutes. Some of the H2 blockers, like famotidine, pepcid, because the effect they have on hormonal. And beta blockers and some of the potassium aspirin, diuretic, like spironolactone, can actually slow it. Yes, inappropriate sexual behavior. Just quickly, I'm not going to go there. What is the major side effect of antidepressant medication on the bottle? Yeah, that's exactly sexual dysfunction. That's why we like that. That's okay, well, somebody has inappropriate sexual, but let's just see about antidepressant, because it may help with agitation and also just decline their sexual life. And in some case reports, citalopram, Paxil, there's been tons of them. Some reports show citalopram is ineffective. Remeron is only helpful in one case, and the only reason was helpful is Remeron in low dose is severely antihistamine and makes a person to sleep for 12 hours. That's why not having an appropriate sexual behavior. And the tricyclic antidepressant, like amitriptyline, nortriptyline, all of them are actually very effective because they are neuropathic antidepressant medication. The only thing is they have a very high anticholinergic side effect. They actually may interfere with a lot of people confused and also have a problem with gait and walking as well. A lot of SSRI are here, mirtazapine, you can use the TCA here, but clomipramine, but again, you see orthostatic hypertension is one of the things. A lot of people on SSRI may actually develop, especially Paxil over the time, tremor as well. That's something that we have to look at it. And again, the trazodone, this can be also helpful, but you have to work on the dose, not 25, 50 milligrams. You have to go 500 milligrams, 450 milligrams. And that causes significant orthostatic hypertension, which means the blood pressure is going to fall when they stand up, increased risk of actually fall. And that's why antidepressant is kind of like the scary in these people. Anti-androgens can be helpful. You can use progesterone injection in them for the fact that actually you bring down the testosterone level. And again, that's something we sometimes use. I actually, I use in two of the patients with inappropriate sexual behavior. But again, it's very, very tricky. I will tell you why. And again, even you can use finasteride medication. I have some articles for you. Low dose again, hormonal things in people showing that if they're not responding to antipsychotic, it can be helpful. But finasteride or Prozac is a medication for big prostate. But the mechanism of that, because it helps for blocking the conversion of the actual testosterone of, to dehydrotestosterone, can be helpful. And again, there's some report of the people, because one of the biggest things on finasteride is decreased libido, and that's good. And they also have effect on erectile function as well. That's what is good. That's what we use. But again, in some of the cases shows that actually when they're using in like 11 men, 6 of them, then in 8 weeks, they're actually showing that they have a response. But 5 of them, they've been alternating as well. Estrogen, you can use it as well in men. You can use either a patch and all this stuff. But again, weight gain, depression, definitely is one of the high risks for the deep brain block thrombosis as well. Quickly, I wanted to just say there is tons of evidence in estrogen. One of the best ones actually is a study of, Bluffstein that actually shows in 39 people that who are not responding to SSRI, they actually use the estrogen and actually has been effective as well. The other one is actually using 1 milligram of systemic estrogen and actually shows that it helps them with the situation. Lupron injection is another one they use. First of all, it's so expensive, and again, it can have a lot of side effects, but again, it's a hormonal analog. It's actually caused the downgrade of the FSH and also LH, but definitely it can help with some ovarian and again, suppression of testicular as well, and that's one of the things that they use. I never use it in my practice, and I don't recommend overall for that, but it's one of the things that some people with a very, very severe case, they may use it as well. Antipsychotic medication, I actually kind of say I'm against of using it, but I'm not against, not against, I'm not a black and white. I would say it's a gray. You can use it in some people. Quetiapine, risperidone. Quetiapine is probably going to be the best one because of sedative effect. Increased risk of fall expectant, and also they may have a weight gain, and also may cause some cardiovascular as well. A lot of anticonvulsive has been done. One of the famous ones is gabapentin. I see a lot of geriatricians and psychiatrists are using this days. I personally, as a geriatrician, don't want gabapentin because of the side effect of the gabapentin in the geriatric population. It's also very confusing and drowsy as well. And there are some cases report of the gabapentin, for people with dementia. But again, it's all the case report, but it's not any specific thing. Cholinesterase inhibitor, which is like Paracet and Exelon and all the stuff that we use, one of the things that's very important is actually one case report showed that some of them that use Exelon or Rivastatin, they have some decrease in inappropriate sexual behavior, but the other one is actually shows that some of them actually may have worsening of the situation as well. That's why it's a very, very controversial to use any of this medication and for this situation. But I see off-label a lot of people using as a patch or something for the people that they have this issue. But to be honest with you, not too much data. Cimetidine or Tagamet is one of the over-the-counter things you can use in a high dose. Definitely cimetidine, as you see a lot of people take cimetidine in a high dose, they actually get the large breasts because it's effects on hormonal. But that's exactly things that they use it. Beta blocker, you can use that. Antifungal medication because it can also block the hormonal things like ketoconazole. And diabetic. Then I put it on the list, but I don't think that it's going to be practical. The major ethical things that we have here is we have, again, the U.S. President's Bill of Rights that if I medicate the person for inappropriate sexual behavior, this is a big autonomy. That's why I'm saying I'm not a good lawyer. But I, in fact, if there's any lawyer sitting here, they're kind of looking at me and say, oh, you're giving medication to someone. And the reason is because, again, first of all, the healthcare provider can say about liability. that happen, again, for complicated the treatment of hypersexuality in the institute? And again, how do the caregivers implement intervention in, again, at least in the restrictedness possible, with ensuring everyone's safety? That's why when it comes to treatment with medication, it comes a lot of documents. It really needs to have a discussion along with all the family and members that do we really want it to be medication before we try any other intervention. As far as the law, as you know, hormonal agent is a very controversial, because if you use any hormonal, you have to see that actually the use of law in the sex offender population. And think about, we have a poor dementia patient and we actually started to give the hormone in order to kill their sexual mechanism or physiology. That it comes to a lot of discussion here. And also at the end, that definitely the hormonal things may increase the risk of TBT and cardiovascular, something we definitely need to have discussion with the family. The final discussion is hypersexuality is a real complex. Again, it can be varied between 2 to 30% of the people. Again, and it's a very, very important that we have a good assessment of the people, always starting with non-medication. Definitely, there are many interventions that we can use to stop that. Again, privacy, redirection, and or maybe using of the male caregiver for somebody as a male demented person, and again, increase their socialization as well. Our job is definitely have a policy and procedure, and please, if you listen to me, if you are in the industry of the long-term care facility, after today, go back to your office and take from your closet all the policy that you have, review it again, and see, do you really have a good policy written for that? Have you discussed with a family member of the patient, people that you have in your facility about this situation can happen? Training. I can't tell you. Study shows how much training can be helpful. This kind of training, smaller group, is actually shows even in like a memory care unit. And again, this possibility shows that definitely can help. The other things is training the caregiver, and also especially the caregiver coming from different culture background, discuss with them about the nature. And finally, a staff can plan for individuals' intervention that the hypersexuality can be more openly addressed. I think I have some minutes. Big discussion, but again, I just try to bring this awareness that this neglected topic should come and discuss more in the different places, because of a lot of things needs to be changed, and especially for the aging population with a lot of dementia. Now, I don't think I have time for questions, but 5 minutes. Okay, well, good. Wonderful.
He, aged 93, had been put on Viagra by his doctor, and he developed a relationship with a 75-year-old woman.
Right.
And the residents were absolutely up in arms because they were fondling at the dinner table. They called her a slut.
Wow.
It wasn't him, it was she. She was the slut. And what was more interesting was the family's reaction to this. They were beside themselves. They were so angry. Mom had only been dead 6 months, and now he's having a relationship with a woman in the facility. And how important it would have been to have had that conversation.
Exactly.
On admission to the facility,
right.
Particularly as the man obviously had a libido that needed to be attended to.
Right, right, yeah. And you're absolutely right. And again, I'm hoping that only one thing that we can take home today is definitely having this conversation. As again, beside of all the instruction we provide for all, I mean, dementia people, just having discussion, because this is one of the biggest ethical, legal, and complex and challenge for you guys in the future if you're taking care of any dementia patients and having the conversation earlier about the situation. Yes, please.
What about protection during sex with STDs really rising among the older population?
Excellent. Great question. Actually, there is not any, I couldn't find any written policy in actually United States. There are some in East Coast part, but you're absolutely right. I actually found a good policy in North Island that actually have about for people with dementia that they should actually be aware of the the protection and using anything like barrier or anything like for during the sexual act. But you're absolutely right, especially for this aging populations that they are getting dementia, a lot of diseases, as you know. I'm not talking about HIV, I'm just talking about herpes. Because in like ancestor We have syphilis was one of the major sexual transmitted diseases. That's why a lot of people think of syphilis one of the risk factors. But right now, beside of HIV, is actually herpes simplex is one of the things that we have to, yes, absolutely. We have to bring it up. You're right, absolutely right. Good, great comments. But I couldn't see anything's policy. I'm a physician. I really don't know a lot. But if you guys have any policy about sexual transmitted disease in your policy, I'd like to look at it. But I couldn't find, I actually found in Northern Ireland. It's interesting. And some in Australia as well, but in the care facility. Question?
This is an uncomfortable question, but how do you get a man with dementia to put on a condom?
Oh, yeah. Good question. You're absolutely right. One of the things that they first do is, I mean, and I saw in the different countries, like I'm not saying here, but I read in the, like a report from the other places, again, Australian Alzheimer Society, they have Alzheimer Society as well. They talking about if they find a person have a penetrating intercourse, do a test in both of them. Because definitely, the one of the other problem is you should have the caregiver go to the privacy room and put the condom on, to be honest. And that's actually disturb everything. That's not a good idea. That's why the best way is actually have a testing of them if you find that they have penetrating intercourse. Unless if they have not very serious sexual transmitted disease and their life expectancy is very low. And this is reality. The other countries, they're talking about it. And that you kind of like say, okay, should we do that or not? Should we go on all the tests and do checking of everything? But definitely some of the basic they do if there is a penetrating intercourse. Yes. But good question. Yeah. That's my point is bring this problem and you guys, every single of you are going to be the person who's going to think about it and be a voice for this, having this discussion and bring more policy, please.
We have one more question here in the back.
So this might be more of a comment than anything, but I went to a lecture on it was called edcure.org. That was the organization that put it on, and it was for impotence in older men. And for a lot of men, it can be very depressing in later years when, you know, if you're on a beta blocker or what have you, that you're not able to have sex. So, you know, the fact that somebody might be able to have sex later on in life when they, for example, now their blood pressure is under control, it actually might help with, you know, I hate to say it, but it might help with cognition, right? So it's just more of a commentary than anything that it's still important to a lot of older men to be sexually viable. And there are a number of methods for both Medicare and Medi-Cal patients available now that weren't available before.
Absolutely, yes, and I completely agree with that. It's a great comment. Yeah. All done? Wonderful. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.